All right, thanks, Justin. Well, this is the artificial intelligence panel. We are in natural intelligence here, so I don't know where the artificial intelligence panel is. Have you found it yet? I have no idea where they are. All right. So, okay, you have, what I like to do is to turn this into a conversation. It's not going to be us saying anything much. It's going to be talking with you, and I would like to hear from you as well. So you have heard enough of ideas and challenges and issues and projects and stuff like that. So given at the beginning when I presented some of the stuff, one of the challenges we have is trying to understand what does it mean to be intelligent. There is a definition of what it means. How much of that do we, or have we seen the Google brain, that's your claim to fame, how much of intelligence do you think there is in Google brain? And you know, so what I'd like to do is to take that question and try and see some answers from the perspective, what is intelligence? What do you think it is? And how does it relate to what we have seen so far? And we take the conversation from there. Again, where are the other mics here? There's one mic there, one mic there. So guys, when you're ready, just run around. It'll be the Oprah Winfrey style, running around and asking for comments and questions, all right? So I'll start with Andrew here.
So I think that technology has come a long way and continues to come a long way. And the main thing that we get is we get better experiences for our life. But if you look at how these work in detail, you see algorithms. And these algorithms are basically more and more sophisticated. And a lot of the algorithms that we used to use and we continue to use seemed very magical before. Like when I was studying computer science, before I took a compiler's course, I thought the compiler was an extremely amazing piece of software. How did this thing take text in and output, assembly code, so I didn't have to think really hard about how to program my, you know, Apple II or whatever I was using. So I think that in that sense, the machine learning algorithms are really a useful tool, but in the sense that they're intelligent, I think the more you look and the more you work at these fields, the less magical it becomes and the more it looks like algorithms that are getting more and more useful and more sophisticated.
Yeah, thank you for having us here. Well, I want to dive in from a little different perspective. I saw quite some interesting talks today, and to take a little overview, what we're seeing is that Google is really active and doing a great job in doing AI also open source. We see that Microsoft is moving into that direction, and we are working with a lot of corporate customers worldwide, and we see that all these companies are also starting to technologize their value chain and base them more and more on data, and now become more and more active and seeing that they will not be capable in doing that by themselves. So they move towards open source environments, also in the AI space. And so the tech companies are already way ahead, of course, and now the old industry is trying to pick up or do something about that. So and that is also because of the algorithms and all that what the tech companies are providing, making it so easy for them to use. So I was wondering if you perceive that as an opportunity that is coming up, if you perceive that as a threat or as a large opportunity for the open source movement, also in AI, that all these like corporate money is moving into the space, and I think that will be very strongly happening in the next years.
I think that's interesting. The question of corporate money going into AI stuff, is that a good thing or a bad thing, Bunny? Corporate money getting into AI.
Yeah.
Do you think that's a good thing or a bad thing?
I think that there's plenty of it's a more general question. I mean, you know, who should be funding research or whatever, these sorts of things. I think that it's perfectly fine for corporate money to be getting into AI or whatever they want to get into, or government money. It's more about the applications and motivations that are behind those particular you know, why are they funding it, and what are they going to what they're trying to do with it at the end of the day?
Yeah. So from that perspective, I mean, would there be okay, like the tool? Okay, Michael, your Suzy tool, right? Do you think there are aspects about the tool that you have that could exhibit the notion of, like the question I asked, intelligence? Does it, I mean, so again, it goes back to the, what would the definition be? Would it be what, you know, what, if I see something, do I know it is intelligent? I know there's a Turing test,
right?
But is that sufficient? It's like someone was asking, can you define what is porn? It's like when you see it, you know.
Right.
But how do you define it? Right? So.
Right.
Yeah, artificial intelligence comes in different flavors, and it's difficult to find the right definition. A good definition is maybe one that's very simple. For example, artificial intelligence is if a machine can do something that a human can do. So humans can do a lot of intelligent things, but also a lot of stupid things, and useful and not useful things. In the past, for example, artificial intelligence was considered in the field of game playing, like being a very good chess player was considered in the 80s, I think. People said machines cannot have that much inspiration like a very good chess player, and it will take a long time until they keep up and play very good chess. But now this game is over. Chess playing is an easy thing. This is kind of a solved problem. But now people say, oh, this was never a problem before because it's just an easy program you have to write, and then you are as intelligent as a human in this field. So human intelligence comes at places where you don't expect that you need so much intelligence, like if it's about driving a car. This was for a long time an unsolved problem, and now in the next years we will see that self-driving cars come there, and they get a license if the number of accidents is one-tenth of what a human would do. So artificial intelligence comes in different places where it's not only about doing a conversation like chatting with each other and expressing emotions and so on, what you would expect if you think about the Turing test. So we have a lot of commercial applications, like, for example, do a financial consultancy. In the past, it's considered that you need an expert to tell you where you should invest your money. And today, you can just put in some numbers on a web page, and if you go to a bank, they do nothing else. They don't do actual consultancy. They just read what's on their page. So you would say this is artificial intelligence, but it still takes a job of a human before. So I think the number of places where technology replaces what humans did will increase very fast, I think. And you wouldn't say this is artificial intelligence, but in the sum of it, I think we see that there is machine intelligence coming and replacing humans, but mostly for a good reason, because they are more safe or cover more information.
Yeah, I think you can debate this for a long time, but one of the most important things about machine learning is it's been useful, and we judge things whether they're useful or not. So you look at the chess example, is it useful for computers to be really good at chess? Well, only so far as you can use it as a trainer to become good at chess to enhance your own enjoyment. I mean, in Google, we have like Gmail, and it has the smart reply. And so you can say, I got a message, and I can say, here are some replies that the machine learning has given me. And if I provide them, if they're good, I can use them. If not, I don't have to use them. But my life has been shortened, the amount of typing that I have to do, because I don't have to think as hard about how I'm going to respond to my email. And I think that's what I find exciting about all the open source is that people can take technology and all these free toolkits and they can plug them into the whatever their software is and make it better. And I think we've only hit the tip of the iceberg on that.
Yeah, and I totally agree, and I think you have two important points, and that matches with yours. I think the AI or machine learning capabilities pop up all over the place, and sometimes we expect it to pop up, like for the cars, sometimes we don't expect it to pop up in that space, but what is happening, and we see that very strongly, is that all of this will, as good as they are, and it will come, they will eliminate a lot of jobs, a lot of white-collar jobs, a lot of like traditional jobs. And we see in most corporates and also governments, we see not enough actually time and also power invested in thinking about what is going to happen to the people that are probably going to lose their jobs in the next few years. And there's a lot of transformation projects going on. And I think there's a lot of good in AI, and it's very important that it comes and it will come, and open source will actually speed or is speeding that up a lot. But we had it a couple of times today, the norms and values around it and what do we do with society is still something that is like widely not really discussed in depth, I think.
So if I were to take that statement slightly further, if you say to be able to create some stuff, right? So is creativity, curiosity, a qualifier for display of intelligence? So can potentially an AI, whatever, create the Novena project?
I mean, I think there's, I don't know, I mean, I'm one of the kids that don't belong here because I'm not an expert in AI, but presumably there's a difference between expertise and like creation and innovation. Right. So what I see people, a lot of what's coming on now are essentially experts, AI experts in driving, AI experts in reading your email, AI experts in advising on things. So they're replacing select human positions because of their expertise that gets rid of a lot of training and otherwise things that you would need to do. But, you know, would I expect a self-driving car to be able to come up with a new sous vide recipe for my salmon belly? No. You know, it's not something that, you know, I would ever expect to come out of, like, an intelligent car, right? And so at what point do the systems become sufficiently, I guess, self-aware that they can rewrite their own rules and say, hey, like, I can reason about where cars are, therefore I should be able to reason about logistics and help plan the routing of packages in UPS, and a car says, you know, actually, you're solving the wrong problem with the traffic flow. Actually, the problem you should be solving is don't send your packages from the depot to here, just do it directly from there, because the car realized that, right, somehow because of the intelligence within. And I don't know at what point, you know, systems can scale up to become, like, intelligent in that fashion, but I think there's, like, definitely I think today what, you know, we're talking about replacing jobs is a lot of expertise being captured in computers, but I don't know if I would qualify that as like intelligence in a like a human sense.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And like going back to like designing a board, if you're placing decoupling capacitors, that's something that a computer could automate, and why doesn't it? Or if you had an auto router that actually worked, you wouldn't have to place all the traces by hand. And so if you had that, would you be out of a job? I think you would just make more boards. And this is kind of what's happened. Whenever you have an assistive technology that makes your life easier, you have more productivity. And musicians had this when the MIDI came out in the 80s. They could start doing their own arrangements. They could start playing with instruments themselves and doing their own orchestrations and seeing what it was going to be like. And they had things like you know, auto arpeggiation and auto rhythms, and these didn't make their creativity any less. Now what we have at Google, there's an open source project about Magenta, which is kind of exploring this whole issue. I encourage you to check it out. But what's cool about it is that you're still directing where it's going to go. Like you might play, you know, four bars of something that's Bach-like, and it's that, oh, I know how to play something that's like that because it's been trained on that. That doesn't mean that it's taking over creativity necessarily. So I think these kind of assistive technologies are what we're really seeing right now, and we're going to continue to see a lot more of them, and we're driving them very well.
So the issue is the question of assisting you rather than and assisting you because you have expertise in that space. So I know I have these four bars of Bach, and I play that, and the system says, oh, I know what this is, and it continues and then innovates on that. Is that a display of intelligence, or is it a display of expertise? So in other words, the way I'm seeing it is the intelligence in the artificial intelligence perspective is very localized. So if you say that the computer beat the human in chess, can that same computer, after the chess game is over, walk away or go drink a beer or do anything like that, which the chess player can do, but the computer is not going to do it? So is that an element that we need to look at? Do you have multifaceted levels of intelligence that you need to in order to make it more holistic?
You can respond to that first, because I was going to take us off topic.
There was the idea around that if you want to make a machine human-like and to give it intelligence, that it must be, it must learn like a human and grow up and be a baby first and learn language and so on, to have all these capabilities to be like a human. But I don't think this holds, and I don't think the comparison is valid that you say if you are intelligent if after a chess game you can do also something else. If the point comes that a machine is more intelligent than human, then they will do the same and do a comparison of the human capabilities if they are able to do what they are doing, because they are able to compute so many numbers and access so many databases, and it's also not valid. So I don't think this is the right way to view about artificial intelligence. Maybe.
Something to add to that?
Yeah, I was actually just going back to your original thing where you're talking about like assistive, sort of how the AI is becoming assistive. One thing you said that I wasn't aware of that was really alarming was when you said that Google Gmail gives you responses that you can give. I mean, I don't use Gmail, but that when you said that, I was like, oh my God, that's like crazy. Because you know, I use SwiftKey, and it has like the little, you know, Markov learning thing that kind of like tries to complete my texts for me. And sometimes I do the thing where I start typing a couple of words, and I just hit the complete button to see what it's learned about me and what it would say. And sometimes the responses are pretty good, right? And I'll just send that. I'm like, oh, that's kind of fun. Or it's not what I intended, but I'll send it just to like troll the other person. But the interesting part, though, is that the thing that's scary to me is that I guess so the assistive technologies make you think that you can do more than you can do. Like if I were to, someone's to give me an assistive technology that would help me place decoupling capacitors on a PCB, but I didn't actually understand why I placed them where I do, that they just seem to look right. People start designing boards where actually capacitors might not go wherever they do, and they'll never have to learn why the capacitors go where they go because they've had the assistive technology. And eventually that computer like exceeds the, like, because we all become so dependent upon it, we never actually learn the real reason why they go. They just all kind of look like they're in the right spot, right? And so at the end of the day, there needs to be like a human sort of intervening and filtering the stuff that's coming out of the assistive technology. And what is a little scary is that inbox responses are very suggestive. Like one thing that I don't like about SwiftKey is that I might want to respond one way to a person, because that's what I feel, but then I'll see this suggestion of what I would have said in another context, and that actually changes how I feel about that topic. Like SwiftKey is now driving me in a way. I really don't like it when I feel like I've lost my sort of, you know, my internal self-compass to that little suggestive thing in the keyboard, right? And having an inbox reply that is suggesting you to what a set of responses are makes you a little lazier. And say you're talking about how to vote, and someone says, hey, like, you know, are you going to vote this way? And it has like a set of responses that you could go for. And whoever wrote the algorithm decides, oh, we're just going to bias it one way or the other, and so that you're going to always respond in favor of one view or another. That response, because you're coming up with in your head how you should respond to that, that AI is actually just whispering in your ear ideas almost. It's like the little devil sitting on your shoulder telling these things. And that to me seems like, that's really scary, like when you start having like suggested responses and tweets and stuff like that. What are
you going to say? So basically, by reading the email, you're also getting that suggestion. So it's not really unique to the, so if you look at your inbox, you've read these email from people and they're creating suggestions in you. Like this is the idea of persuasion
right.
of an email. So this is happening from spam. But I mean, I wasn't responsible for creating this technology, but this is one of the things that Google looks at when they implement it is how to balance these trade-offs and how to make sure that that privacy is maintained as well, you know.
But I mean, so the key difference is that for someone to persuade me, another human must make the effort, I mean, as little as it is, to forward it to me, right? And, or they have to be a script that's mailbotting, whatever it is. The difference is that when there's a single centralized AI, whoever controls the parameters on the AI can actually, they don't even have to know the people or the conversation or whatever it is. They just load the parameter set to sway the responses in a particular way. They're completely non-contextual influence and biasing of the conversations, of every single conversation that's on Gmail. So the amount of power that's embedded into that kind of AI system and how it's programmed and how the weights of the network are set can have systemic effects. And when you're looking at elections that are decided by 1%, 2% of a population vote, you all of a sudden realize this may be the most powerful lever to turn in the world.
So, I mean, the algorithms that we use are based on, you know, research that we publish and open source algorithms that we have. And these are constantly being evaluated, and sort of bias in the algorithms is a research topic, and I'm not an expert on it, but yeah. It's definitely something that is aware of.
Let me take the opportunity to open it to the floor. Yes, someone at the back there. Where's the mic? Oh, you have it. Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have two questions. One is, how is AI going to affect skilled human jobs? And the other one is, what is your opinion on how real is the risk of Skynet-like event?
All right, Skynet. I was waiting to hear Skynet. First time I'm hearing it today. So, question, is AI going to replace jobs? Is that the first one? And the second one is, when is Skynet happening? I hope you know what Skynet is. Yeah, go ahead.
I would like to answer with a quote of the former chief technology officer of IBM, Gunter Dück, in Germany. And he said that all jobs will be taken over by machines instead of one, information technology jobs. Because of all the abilities which are there, even the job of a doctor and everything else that you can think of can be replaced by artificial intelligence, big data, and moving machines. But only one is left, that of information technology.
Yeah, and it's also not about being scared about. I think this major shift, like you say, will happen. And what I was stating before is that it's up to also the corporates and the governments, and also us to think about how to like keep up with the speed of a shift. I mean, if we look at cars, if we look at also like decision making processes in companies, they will be highly taken over by more data driven systems, I would say, and also by AI systems. And this is nothing to be scared of, because it will happen, and it's good it happened due to the efficiency reasons and also to like more productivity and all that stuff. But I think it will happen much faster than the examples you mentioned before. It happens much quicker, and I think that's just important that we also think about how can we actually support these people in like moving quickly forward into new like productive jobs then.
So does it mean that Does it mean that geeks will finally inherit the world?
We would like it here, yes, okay.
So we have job security, guys, so we are okay. So it's the others who have a problem, so all right. Did that kind of answer your question for you? All right, another question, someone else. Is there somebody at the...
Yeah, okay.
Oh, there you are, okay.
You were talking about Turing tests, and I think that it's not very valid anymore. Like, it should be more like physical tests. That, for example, can we think a very simple example that I could ask a robot to tie my shoes? How long, simple question, how long it will take that I can, let's say, so for a robot that this is how you tie my shoes, and it would tie them. It's like, seems for us very simple problem, but it's actually very complex because it's like in three-dimensional movement and you curve the shoelaces, so it's seems very complex. Which one is more difficult, driving a car or tying my shoes for the robot?
Tying a shoelace, right? Which one is more difficult, tying a shoelace or driving a car? Which one is more difficult for a robot? Is that your question?
Well, yes.
There's a difference between robotics and AI, though, I think. So there's a, like, tying a shoelace doesn't have the ethical decision of do I run into a group of people or do I ram into the other car in front of me, which is something that a self-driving AI has to make, right? So there's a different sort of parameter set there. So building robots that can, one thing that you find, like, if you look on factory floors and stuff, they talk about, oh, robots replacing human factory workers. And one of the hardest problems is that programming a robot to just, like, pick something up and move it around is, you know, requires an engineer that gets paid six figures. And so a lot of factories don't replace human jobs because there's a limiting factor of people can program the robots to, you know, replace the humans because of the exact problem. But there's a whole field of people who are building robots that you can teach. You know, it's a general 3D robot, and it has eyes, and you, like, show it a job, and then it tries to replicate it in a very natural sort of copy, see what you do, you know, and reproduce that motion. And a lot of the limitation there is it's a lot of it's around the mechanics, and a lot of around sort of the vision problems and so forth. I think eventually they'll get good enough that they'll build a robot that can, you can just show how to tie a shoe, and they can do it. But there's a lot of sort of just technical dexterity issues that you can't conflate with the idea of artificial intelligence. I mean, the idea of solving a knot problem, I think, again, is more like expertise. You can build an algorithm that can do that, but the problem is building the mechanics that can grasp the shoelace is a separate problem from the intelligence to learn how to tie a shoe.
Yeah, but can it, like, understand what I do? For example, if I would sew with my hand that this is how you write, then could it... Like, is it possible that, when can we build this kind of device that can see with the camera what I saw and then it mimics it and learns, like, how to do physical interaction? Like, I think there's AI involved in that.
Yeah, they are building those systems, but it's a bit different than the stuff, a lot of the big data sort of AI that you guys have been talking about.
I think one of the things you want to keep remind ourselves is, I think it was... Neil deGrasse Tyson, in one of his shows, he mentioned the difference between us humans and our next nearest mammalian intelligent being is 0.5% in our genes. And you know how different chimpanzees are from us. Can chimpanzees, for example, have this conversation as we are having today? Even maybe a chimpanzee can tie a shoelace, I don't know. Maybe a chimpanzee can. But the chimpanzee does exhibit what we would call intelligence to a certain extent. So the difference between us and 5% or 0.5% difference to the next level, could that be what machine intelligence would be? So they are so different from us that we look like chimpanzees to machine learning algorithms as what chimpanzees looks to us. From an intelligence perspective. Think about that. Any comments?
I would like to comment on your statement where you said, is the Turing test valid anymore as a criteria? And I think you're right. It's pointing to the wrong direction if you want to see what machine learning can do and artificial intelligence in general. But it's still an inspiration. It's because the Turing test raises philosophical questions. But to detect artificial intelligence or to show what it can do, it's maybe pointing in the wrong direction.
Okay, we've got a question here.
Yeah, so what I understand from the discussion is that, I mean, AI and or robots both will take over our jobs, basically. So my question is rather, you know, what does it mean for the society as such? So what's the impact on all of us? So we heard just recently, we heard a couple of people talking about, let's say, a basic income, like Elon Musk or Joe Kaeser, Siemens CEO, or Bill Gates talking about tax on robots, stuff like that. So what can we do to know that the society, that it still works as it works, tax systems, things like that?
I think one of the things that you may want to look at is, I mentioned this in my opening remarks, that there is this project, the group of people who came together in January in California, Future of Life. So they have a set of 23 principles of AI that they have crafted. And I think one of the comments, one of the stuff that you're mentioning is one of in that 23 items, which means essentially the humans are meant to be default to be higher ranking than AI algorithms are supposed to be. So we are trying, we need to try to create some kind of a mechanism where we manage the algorithms in the AI space. So you don't want to have two AI systems trying to compete with each other to the detriment of all of us. So there's some ideas there. So I think this is something that we need to have an ongoing conversation. We need to figure out what it means to all of us. Is there a line there? Oh, there is a line there. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I hope I gave you an answer. So you want someone to reply?
Yeah, he wanted to.
Well, I think my comment is that, again, if you want to understand machine learning and what it really can do, you should experiment with it and understand it. And there's playgrounds to understand what neural networks do and how the algorithms are working. And as open source engineers, you are all capable of doing that. And the more we can make these tools and machine learning algorithms accessible to people that don't program would be a great way to get this understanding out so that people realize in a concrete way what things are actually happening right now.
Okay, thank you.
Just ask for comments from the panel about the use of AI in the fields of literature and science.
So the use of AI in literature and science?
Yes.
Is that a question? Literature, yeah. Literature and science.
No, literature and arts.
And arts. Okay. So what you're talking about the use of AI in those two fields?
Yes.
Any comments, gentlemen?
I already pointed out the Project Magenta, which is a Google project to help with music composition. There's also many papers on stylization, where you take in different styles and it allows you to apply them to new images, including kind of a real-time technique where you can blend different styles. I have kind of an animated GIF of it in my talk tomorrow. But I think it's really an interesting thing. And you know, my background is in computer graphics, and a lot of that is trying to figure out how artists should interact with computers. And there's been a huge step in computer animation towards more technical ways of doing computer graphics. And I think the same is going to happen with machine learning and imagery and music.
Okay, another question. So what is the possibility that AI will actually achieve emotion?
We achieve emotion?
Yes.
What is the possibility of AI achieving emotion?
I mean, the possibility that AI will have emotions.
I don't know.
And you can ask yourself, why is it useful for humans to detect something like beauty? Why do you think? Why is it useful to think something is beautiful for humans? What is this? What is it? What is your use in life? Maybe you are able to perform in some way better, and that's the reason we have this kind of emotion. And there could be an analog way that machines detect that they find some beauty in their environment, because they say, I'm able to function better in this environment, therefore I'm seeking for this kind of beauty. So maybe it can be important, but for a practical purpose. But maybe we humans have the same practical purpose. So it's also a philosophical question.
All right, so next person. Oh, this mic.
Hello. Motions. I have a question about...
Closer to the mic, please. I can't hear you.
I have a question about the multiple AI implementations where one company does NLP, the other one does a little big data, maybe somebody does something else. There is some... Google is in good in some stuff, Microsoft, IBM, or any other third-party implementations, they have different characters. And the question just came about the Skynet. There is no parallel in the Skynet concept. There is no parallel second AI. Do you think that those implementations, they somehow get merged into one single AI, or do you think there will be multiple AIs existing in the world and maybe coordinating and talking to each other, and then we just take part of this interesting multi-AI society, like multiple gods or single god?
So multiple AI coming together to become...
And become one single AI.
One single AI is called Skynet.
Or not only Skynet, but I mean maybe the things is about computation power. And if the one who has the most computation power will most probably win this race. And do you think that an alternative without that much power can somehow run in this race or has a chance? There will be only one winner, or that's obvious.
Can I?
Yes. Yeah, please.
Services in the internet should be decentralized because it's better for everyone. We have a lot of centralized services now. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a good idea to formulate the same for artificial intelligence. Centralized artificial intelligence may be bad for humanity, and decentralized may be better.
Mm-hmm. So the answer is decentralized is good, centralized is no good.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. This mic.
So the topic of the conference is the open source part of it and the power of individual, right? And throughout the talk, you know, we came to this topic of, hey, there are, you know, publications out there that everybody can access. There were days that, for example, Steve Jobs and Woz could sit in their garage and then write code, or Hadoop in the Google can, you know, become very big, and everybody could do it on their own. But isn't it a little bit, you know, kidding ourselves to think today that we have this power of actually working on open source level on AI, artificial intelligence, and neural networks, knowing that they actually need super, super, you know, big kind of resources to be able to work on that. And this kind of towards this democratization of AI, that at the moment most of the power is in the hand of Google because they have super resources behind them, while a guy in a garage actually cannot make something like that happen.
So basically, if you look at the kind of computation power you need to do research in AI, it's typically you can do many papers on a single GPU. So I think in the way that computation is really quite commoditized and affordable, you can do a lot on your own. At the same time, there are cloud services where if you get a community together, you can get significant resources in order to do AI. In addition, a lot of the open source toolkits are providing pre-trained models, and these types of things like the ImageNet model that Google provides give you a checkpoint that you can use immediately for inference and do a lot of applications
the,
like
the
you can
The power is not in computation, it's in the data itself. Who can store all this data that's out there? Right? You know, ask Watson guys. They will tell you the IP is in the data, not in the tools.
Well, no, there's power in the algorithms too. Like, there's powers in the architecture. Like, what most is done with deep learning right now is, what is the exact architecture where you connect, how many layers should I do? How many skip connections, for example? So these things, you can then take your data and you can apply it to a pre-trained model and get a specialized result. So for example, there's a tutorial on our website which allows you to specialize the ImageNet so you can detect flowers. And people have done lots of interesting things with that, including use it as like I think there was a train detector for a Raspberry Pi.
I think we can only take one more question. So, eeny, meeny, miny, moe. Yours, because you're up. Sorry.
Yeah, thank you for your enlightenment on a lot of things here. So, on the topic of deep learning, a few weeks ago, I posted this question on my website, is that can deep learning actually count the number of fishes in the ocean? I'm not talking about species, I'm talking about counting. And my answer and my challenge is it can't. So I'd like to hear the panelists' view. I have a second question, which is rather short. It's about democratizing IP addresses. In what direction does AI do on democratizing IP addresses? Thank you.
All right. Second question is to democratize IP addresses. I have no idea. Maybe we are the wrong panel for that. We need to ask the AI to answer that.
Maybe somebody in the audience.
Somebody else in the audience can answer that second question. Nobody? All right. You have an answer for that? Mike. Can't hear you.
What precisely do you mean when you say, I don't know where she went?
She's right here.
Yeah. Oh. Democratizing IP addresses.
What does that mean?
Specifically the word democratizing.
Because currently is controlled, unless you say it isn't.
Okay. I mean, that's why I asked for clarification. I think, pretty sure what she meant by controlled is the ICA are the people who decide, you know, A level, B, C, and then D level IP address. I think that's what she meant by democratizing.
While you're thinking about it, let me go to the first question. Can AI count the number of fish in the sea? That's your question, right? First question.
Difficult to imagine for me.
I mean, if you actually want to count the fish, you have to have something that can see the fish first. And so, I mean, I guess, I think you could build, you know, it wouldn't necessarily even be an AI problem. It's more of just, can I build a sensor network big enough? Or, I don't know, maybe you can build something where you take all the sonar pings from all the networks of all the subs and do some deep learning on it and figure out how many fish based upon the interference pattern or something. But it seems different, right?
You could argue that you can only count in a statistical sense, like all counting methods are based on, if I sample this in a certain region, then I'm going to see this many fish, and therefore it extrapolates to some estimate.
I really like to challenge this because there are many reasons that force me to say that it's not possible, at least in the near future, because all these things that you've just mentioned, that can be done because fish do not stay static in a place. They move all the time. and there's fish migration, the pattern can change, depend on climate, and all sorts of patterns are in the ocean. So this is a near impossible question. So actually I'm here to ask these luminaries in the panel to enlighten me, because it's a real question. It's not, I posted this today, it's a few weeks ago, it's on my web pages.
I think there's an easy answer. Following the definition of artificial intelligence, you can say that a machine is doing what a human would do, and that means do a reasonable guess.
Yeah. I mean, I think also if you turn it the other way, is like, can the humans count the number of humans that we have in the world? The answer is no. Like, censuses are extremely hard. We don't actually know how many people are in a given country or area at any given time for the exact problems you point out. People are being made, people are dying, people are moving. And so, you know, yeah, it's a hard question.
I think I wouldn't want to count the number of fish, but I love the fish on the grill. Okay? That's what I like. We are out of time, actually. So am I out of time? Can I have a few more minutes? No?
I just wanted to make a comment on that.
Okay.
The lady mentioned that there's the complication of counting fish is because of the fact that the fish move. There's another aspect to it, which is the lifetime of a fish, right? So you need to be able to count all of the fish in the sea in the time that the shortest lived fish lives, right? So it's not just a question of counting the number of fish in the sea, it's also being able to count fast enough, which is probably a far more complicated mechanical problem, not exactly an AI problem.
Well, there's also a biological question of what is a fish. I mean, I'm sure if you got out
exactly
of everything
too.
In the ocean,
yeah.
You know, and you showed an expert everything in the ocean, there'd be species that we don't even know if they're fish or not or what. So
I think it's a dangerous question, because artificial intelligence with superpower would try to dry out the sea to count the fish.
We'll dry out the sea to count the fish, all right? So it's as opposed to boiling the ocean, right? So, all right. Well, on that fishy note, all right, we've come to an end of what I enjoyed as a panel discussion. I hope, gentlemen, you had fun time as well. And thank you for the questions from the audience. And so Andrew, Michael, Stefan, and Andrew. Thank you very much for your time and your comments and your conversation. And thank you, everybody, for your patience and as well as your interesting questions. And I think with this, we are done, right?
Yes,
okay.
So
thank you very much, guys. Thank you.
Let's have a round of applause for our panelists for artificial intelligence.